habit. A boundary is a habit. If you can really deeply relax the habit of maintenance of boundaries,
right.
you will find yourself in boundarylessness states.
Good. 3, 2, 1. Okay, everybody, welcome to this Dharma discussion with Stephen Fulder, and I'm very happy that that you're joining me for this special Dharma presentation for our students in the Aikido, or the meditation for Aikidoka. Aikidoka means Aikido students, so it's like yogi, but an Aikido yogi. And thank you for joining me today, Stephen.
I'm really delighted. And we've known each other a long time, and we've been along in a sort of brotherhood in the Dharma for a long time, so I'm really delighted.
Well, with that, maybe I'll do a little introduction for Stephen, for the students who don't know Stephen. Stephen Fulder he's one of Israel's leading spiritual teachers. And it says here on your bio that you were the founder of the Insight, Israel Insight Society, which in Hebrew is Tovana. Did you co-found that, or were you the first person to found it? Because that was before my time here in Israel.
Yeah, it was basically my initiative from the beginning, but obviously as it became an organization, there were pioneers involved as well. But when I arrived in Israel in the early 80s, I was the only kind of Buddhist practitioner in the country,
wow.
I think.
Well, yeah.
And so a lone fish. But then I realized we need an organization. And so it's grown hugely now. But I was the start of it, yes.
Well, I know that you're certainly seen as the, maybe it's, forgive the phrase, but the spiritual father of certainly Vipassana meditation and Tovana, which is the Insight Society here in Israel. And I'll just continue on with a little bit of your bio. It says that Stephen's been teaching Buddhist teachings and meditation practice to thousands of people for over the last 20 years, and he draws on 40 years of deep personal experience of Vipassana meditation and mindfulness-based meditation and Dharma practice, as well as the immeasurable wisdom of the Buddhist traditions to help us rediscover the magic of the moment and the great heart and the big mind that lies just beyond the surface. And also, in addition to being a Dharma teacher, Stephen is also involved in peace work and Dharma activism, which we will speak about a little bit towards the end. And just to kind of let the viewers know, Stephen and I agreed that this conversation, you know, as the Dharma is vast, it could go any direction. But we're going to try to speak a little bit about meditation at the beginning, and then speak about how meditation contributes to inner peace, and how once we've kind of achieved a certain amount of inner peace, how that has an impact in the world. How does that sound to you, Stephen?
That sounds great. Yeah,
great.
I'm ready for it.
Well, so look, I've been teaching this course for already 3 months, and it's going to go on for several months. It's a year long. It's a year long cycle, and so they're hearing from me all the time about meditation. So maybe we'll just start there with you, and what is meditation?
Well, it's an interesting point that Einstein made when he said you can't solve problems with the same mind that created them. And we're so used to trying to solve our problems through more thinking, more cogitation, rumination, struggle, conflict, despair. And meditation is simply stepping into another sense or another quality of knowing where a certain free readiness and depth of awareness is like a shining a light from really another place that is not just the usual conceptual mind onto, of course, not only our problems but our existence. So it's really like shining a light on our existence. And one model that I like to use is the iceberg. Because in the iceberg, you have 10% above the water and 90% below. And we largely live our life on a kind of automatic pilot and the living on the 10%. And yet it's the 90% under the water that will solve our problems and that will bring us freedom and liberation and bring us to another place. We can't access that 90% really, unless we have other tools.
Mm.
So that it is, I think, in our tradition as human beings to develop tools of seeing that go under the night, go into the 90%, go under the surface. You talked about the surface just now.
Mm.
Go under the surface and look at the things as they really are and not as the conceptual interpretations of them. And there we find not only solving our problems, but our liberation. Just a word about meditation.
Sure.
I like to kind of disengage undo conceptual ideas of meditation.
Yeah.
And that meditation with a capital M, doesn't that interest me? And it's something we can bring up a bit later. But conceptual views of meditation include, for example, forced calmness or a pressure to accept, or pressure to be super concentrated.
Right.
And I like to kind of get out of these models of meditation and understand that meditation is a direct knowing, is like a direct seeing. It's shining a light on the reality.
Mm.
And indeed, all sorts of qualities come into that meditation, such as calmness is part and stopping the automatic behaviors of running around and rushing about and all that. It's all part of it. But it's fundamentally an application of a clear mind to the moment.
That's interesting. So when somebody makes a shift from, let's say, an egoistic life or a material life, and they have the notion that they want to become more spiritual or more, they can make that shift, and part of that new spiritual identity can be, oh, I should be calm, or I should accept everything, or I should be a peaceful person. But you're saying that can also be, which are clearly benefits of meditation, but it can also be just another concept.
Yes, it can be, and it can be controlling and even despairing, because when there's no calm, the mind is going crazy, there's a cacophonia in the consciousness, and then everyone says, oh, it's not for me, let the others do, let the Buddhists do the meditation in their caves, I'm in the modern world, it's not relevant to me at all, I'm just like that, I've got ADHD, I've got, I can't meditate. In fact, it's a misunderstanding of what is the nature of meditation.
Right.
We just need to drop these expectations, and we can't force calmness. It's a sort of oxymoron. Calmness cannot be forced. Right. Calmness has to arise by itself. And a calmness is there when the disturbance is less disturbing. So we need to be, in a way, very accepting and aware and intimate with the non-calmness,
right,
not just trying to go for calmness.
Right.
So that's a good example. Peace can't be forced. Then you're just actually in the wrong direction. You're trying to manipulate something which
right,
really should arise naturally.
Yeah.
When the disturbances to it or disturbances of it are reduced, then peace arises naturally. It's not something that you can hunt for.
Mm-hmm.
Having said that, I would say peace is a quality that's part of meditation. Calmness is partly arising, and it is helpful in meditation. It's not that I have a negative view of these. These are very important states of mind-body, but we have to kind of be very honest and truthful and awake, and then peace comes in a way,
exactly,
as a result of that.
You know, it's very similar, just if I say a word about Aikido, because Aikido, it's a martial art, but it has a spiritual core that was from an awakening that the founder came up with Aikido. And the Japanese word Aikido means the way of harmony. And sometimes, especially when somebody kind of shifts their identity towards away from fighting, which is a good shift as far as I'm concerned, and towards peace, they can somehow unconsciously also put the concept that no, we have to be peaceful because we're practicing Aikido. And there's a certain aversion towards conflict because we're practicing Aikido. We're peace lovers. And I have also noticed in Dharma communities, sometimes there's an aversion towards conflict, which, sure, if we had to choose, you know, we prefer peace over conflict. But in like in Aikido, it is translated as the way of harmony, but harmony is actually not the steps that we take on the path. The steps that the path of Aikido goes through the field of conflict. And only when it's conflict done correctly or done well, that harmony is a byproduct of the practice. And in some ways, my feeling as well, you know, you sit down and meditate and in 15 minutes you realize, well, this is not a very peaceful practice at all with everything that's going on in the mind. But if you're able to kind of be, you know, have energetic effort, mindfulness and concentration, the byproduct or the result of that will be a state of peace.
It will be. It just reminds me of a cartoon that I saw once many years ago in a spiritual newspaper about a woman that was sitting in meditation for 40 minutes and she was going through hell. Yeah. Her mind was going crazy. She was full of disturbance, of conflict, of emotions, of disturbance and so on. And at the end of 45 minutes, the teacher came over to her and said, "Wasn't that relaxing, my dear?"
Exactly. Well, in a way, this kind of brings us to the first noble truth, the truth of suffering or the truth of unsatisfactoriness, or, you know, that it's not something that's there all the time, but it's our job as yogis to deeply accept that, yes, you know, there's good days and there's bad days, there's peaceful moments and there's conflict moments, but the ultimate direction that things are moving toward is always a dissolution or dissatisfaction that we can't hold on to reality. And only by embracing that can we actually begin to shift that view from, you know, an aversion towards dissatisfaction or dukkha into something that accepts it when it's here and then allows it when it goes.
It's a very important principle in the Dharma. From the earliest talks of the Buddha after his first enlightenment, when he was basically challenged to answer, why is it that if we have a Buddha nature and if we have pure being inside us, such as pure peace, pure calm, pure awareness, which is there as part of our nature, otherwise we would never be able to experience it at all. And the third noble truth, which is the truth of awakening, is not an abstract and it's not unreachable, and it's not something beyond just for the kind of monks that practice 40 years in a cave. It has to be a truth, meaning something applicable for our lives.
Unreachable.
Therefore, it's part of our nature in a deep way. The gift of the Dharma was that the Buddha responded to the question, why don't we have it all the time, by saying, we've covered it over. We've covered it over with peel, with layers. We have to unpeel the obstacles to it, and then it shines out by itself.
Yes,
and it's a very important principle in the Dharma that we're not reaching for the Messiah, to use a word that's popular here in this part of the world. we're not reaching beyond the clouds for liberation. We have to look directly at who we are and where we are and what we are and what is this direct experience, because liberation happens in the moment of experience. It's inside experience. It's not somewhere else. Therefore, if we try and manufacture artificially a kind of state of peace or calm, we're actually creating more of the problem called attachment. The first noble truth of suffering goes with the second noble truth, which is attachment. We only suffer because we're stuck. And we're stuck with the concepts and with automatic behaviors and automatic views and with the obstacles and with the patterns and with the resistances and with the conflicts and so on. And we're sort of stuck with it. And it's such a big package. We don't quite know what to do with it. Yes. And I think it's very wise in Aikido and also in the Dharma to say, we can't expect to be beyond conflict because conflict is so fundamental to the human being. And why is it fundamental to the human being? It comes directly from the basic biological force of protection, of survival. And it's so deep, it's not a thought. It's not a conflict.
It's prior to thought. It's like hardwired.
It's hardwired. Yeah, yeah. And so many people in the Dharma community, and really now I'm talking to people who, you know, maybe in your audience that have been practicing for many, many years, and ask you, please, don't be despaired. If you've been practicing 20 years and you get up in the morning and you fight with your partner, it is because conflict is so deep and so constructive.
Exactly. Yeah.
And it's biological, and it's also around something even more fundamental. It's around the dualistic nature of our mind. So the mind is creating dualism in an automatic way.
Right.
The fundamental dualism is self and other.
Other.
So as we've built a self, so we build other. Self and other are the basis of conflict.
Right.
We cannot expect, as long as we have selfing going on, we cannot expect to be free of conflict.
Right.
So not to kind of go down on ourselves. And if we do find ourselves in conflict, the first thing is to understand we can be compassionate on ourselves because conflict is so fundamental. Don't take it personally. Yeah. It's samsara.
It's
the first noble truth in operation. Don't take it personally. Have some compassion. Yes, I've been practicing 20 years and I still have a bit of conflict left. Here it is. Right. I see it. It needs softness and understanding.
Yeah. And not only that, I mean, in a state of non-self, let's say that, you know, when the self disappears, the other disappears as well. But as we, in that state of non-self, okay, maybe we have a peaceful experience. It's a temporary state until I stop meditating. I get up in the morning and I meet my partner and we have a little conflict. But it's also in that conflict when we have enough capacity to approach it with more mindfulness and intention to see it through, that's where we develop the skillful means. That's where that's the actual ground of practice that helps us to navigate and become not just more capacity, like in a Dharma sense, but also more skill in how to work with conflict.
Exactly. I love, if you, we'll go into conflict a little bit.
Sure.
And one of the, I think the, a key very first issue or first thing to do with conflict, which actually taught me as a child, which is when you're in conflict, breathe.
Yeah.
And but I love the story of Angulimala, a traditional Buddhist story, where he was a brigand and he was in the forest and he killed 999 people. And the Buddha went into the forest and said, he's really suffering. I need to help him. And all the monks said, no, don't go there. He'll kill you. We need you. The Buddha said, he won't kill me. Don't worry. And he went into the forest and Angulimala chased him and he couldn't catch him, although the Buddha actually wasn't running. He was walking. But the Angulimala simply couldn't catch him. And Angulimala said to the Buddha, stop, stop. And the Buddha turned to him and said a beautiful line, which has been like really with me in my mind for years. Mm. The Buddha said, no, you stop. I stopped a long time ago.
Nice.
And it's beautiful because it's the first step, because in the case of Angulimala, that was all that was needed actually to shift the whole thing. He stopped from his usual patterns enough to allow the Buddha to give him Dharma. And then he became an arahant in the end, an enlightened person. But it was that stopping. So when we find ourselves in conflict, and the conflict can be with our partners at work, with the neighbors, in any place, in any moment, it can erupt very spontaneously in the street. And of course, you know, between peoples, 100 years of conflict in the Middle East with no solution in sight. So conflict is can be at any time, in any moment. But if we can, the first thing to do is just take a break, stop.
Yeah.
And that is a window, because conflict is always built on chains of cause and effect.
Exactly.
With someone presses our buttons, then we respond automatically through fear, reaction, anger, and response. Reactivity, and then comes action, words, thoughts, defense, and so on and so on. And it's all rather fast and automatic.
Mm.
So if we can just stop, and then that allows us to work with the Dharma with conflict. And the work with the Dharma with conflict is just as you said, to be aware of this chain that started from someone pressing our button. Be aware of the button and what it is.
Right.
Be aware of defensiveness be aware of the vulnerability in us that makes us want to defend ourselves.
Right.
When someone is actually not holding a gun to our head, but you're just telling us you're an idiot. But it's enough.
But it feels the same. It feels the same as if somebody was holding a gun. Energetically, or the endorphins are flying through. Not the endorphins. The adrenaline is flying through the system as much as if it were a real danger rather than just a perceived danger.
Yeah, it's a danger to the self. Right. The self sees it as danger to itself. Right. It's not a danger to the body. If someone says you're an idiot, it's not a danger to no one hurting you. But the self sees it as a danger to the self.
Exactly.
And most of the self activity of selfing is defensiveness. The self is busy defending itself. It was originally developed as a mechanism to defend the body, but it got out of control and ended up defending itself. So when the conflict is a situation mostly where we're not in danger, but the self is operating to defend itself.
Right.
And so we can see that chain of development as it's happening with awareness, see it as being painful, have compassion on ourselves. Mm. Don't add more layers of blame and of guilt that we are in the conflict again. But be aware of the rising of that energy of defensiveness, conflict, anger, heat, and vulnerability, and watch it arise and go. And this can be quite fast.
Yeah.
And once we see it, it can actually dissolve in a moment because we catch it early.
Right.
And then we can turn to our partner who is giving us the trouble and say something like, well, okay, I hear you. Or someone in the street who's shouting at you, you can just turn to them with a smile and say, what was that really necessary?
Well, not only that, when we shift out of it, when we become disarmed, miraculously it has an effect, a kind of a dharmic effect on the other person, that they also relax, that it disarms them. We don't have to do anything to convince them. It can. I mean, we have to respect the there's a certain karmic momentum that's, you know, from all these, in my case, 53 years of defending the self. It doesn't turn off like that. But I can become aware of it, and miraculously, when one disarms, the other one, you know, as the karmic momentum settles down, the other will become disarmed, and then we're back in this quote of Einstein, you know, the conflict can't be resolved from that same level of thinking that created it. But when one dissolves and the other disarms, then something completely shifts.
Absolutely, because you've shifted into another mode. Yeah. You've shifted into awareness mode. And into tolerance mode, and into allowing mode, and into wisdom mode.
Yeah.
And the self then has less control, less room, and you're not in automatic anymore. Yeah. At that point, not only does it have an effect on the other person, but actually you can begin to see the other person with new eyes. So with compassion, for example, to the partner or the person that's shouting at you, you can look and see, you know, the way they really are. You can understand things a bit differently. You know, there's a famous Tibetan story that I can quickly relate about two guys going into the market, and one of them got hit with a stick from someone in the crowd, and he began to shout at the stick, and his friend said, "Why are you shouting at the stick? It's a bit stupid. Shout at the hand that hold the stick, because it's not the stick that's actually, it's the hand,
yeah, right."
So he started to shout at the hand, and then his friend said, "Well, maybe you shout at the arm, you know, that's holding the hand." Oh, yeah, it's more sensible. So he started to shout at the arm, and then, he said, "Well, you know, there's a person behind that arm,
right?
Maybe you shout at the person whose arm it is that's holding the stick." He said, "Yeah, of course, that's right, yes." So he started to shout at the person. And then his friend said, "Well, look, you know, the person is the result. Maybe the person didn't have any breakfast. Maybe he was miserable.
It's not his fault.
it's a thousand causes that made this person so upset and angry. You should be shouting at the causes that made that person hit you with a stick."
Right.
And his friend said, "Yes, of course." And then, "Oh, but wait a minute. But the causes are the whole universe."
Exactly.
Exactly.
Yeah, right,
So that
right.
takes the sting out of conflict, the personal out of conflict. So when you see the causes of conflict in somebody else, you see their pain and their fear or their irritation or their limitation, and their automatic behaviors or thoughts, patterns, then the whole thing can shift, and you can actually then work together to solve the problem. And
Right.
we did a lot of that in the peace work, a lot of that
Yeah.
kind of work.
Well, maybe this is a good segue to shift into kind of meditation and inner peace, because as you know, one of the doctrines of Buddhism is dependent origination. And as we develop our mindfulness, we're able to kind of follow that chain of events from the hand, metaphorically the hand, the arm, the person, the karma, whatever. You know, we're able to see more and more the buttons being pushed, the way that our mind is operating, the cause and effect of things, the chain of the unconscious chain of thoughts that just keep going. And when we're able to assert mindfulness into that moment that the button is pushed, you might see the trigger, but if mindfulness is there, then you'll see the dissolution. And
Yes, you
then
will.
no, in that moment, karma is not created. And so how does this relate to inner peace?
Because you're not attached to automatic reactivity and to patterns of thought and consciousness and history and conditioning that control you. You've undone them. So, well, it's easier actually to see it in a part of the conflict process, say anger.
Yeah.
If you look closely at the arising of a moment of anger, and you look at it in some, the most easy way to look at it, for example, in the body, in the stomach. You look at the anger as it arises in the stomach as a phenomena. It wasn't there before. Something happens. The stomach contracts, and the stomach then, after a while of anger, the heat rises. You may say words, you may shout, you may do things, but the whole thing arises and vanishes.
Right.
It has a very short shelf life.
Yeah.
It passes.
Unless we fuel it. If we fuel it, it keeps burning. But with
Yeah.
mindfulness, the shelf life is actually, the fuel diminishes very quickly.
Yes. Yeah. It goes by itself anyway.
Yeah.
Even if you don't, you're not mindful, the anger won't stay forever. It'll be
Right.
interrupted by a telephone call, and then you've totally forgotten,
Or lunch.
or lunch, exactly, but or some other thought.
Sure.
But so anger will always go. The interesting place is when the anger has gone, it opens a space of freedom. If we look carefully at a moment of anger or a moment of an emotion or a moment of attachment, when the attachment passes, you will and you may notice that it kind of disappears into background or into a kind of just a knowing which doesn't have that strong form in
Right.
it.
Yeah.
And that knowing is the kind of default knowing, and that's a peaceful place. It doesn't have strong forms. It doesn't have strong reactivity. So at the end of anger, you can notice quiet. At the end of conflict, you can notice quiet. If you disintegrate conflict, dissolve conflict, you will find yourself in a place of a peaceful awareness.
Right.
It will just happen to you that it will be clear that instead of conflict, there is another sea, if you like, an
Right.
ocean
Yeah.
of awareness, where you're still there, you're still awake, you're still sort of responding or knowing what's going on to the world, but you're no longer trapped in that strong reactive form. And in relation to that form, it feels very peaceful.
Right, yeah. And I mean, you know, straight from, Dharma is, that peaceful is not a, it's not a state of that peace exists in our consciousness. It's when the self relaxes. It's the non-existence of self, which is our nature anyways. But when we stop selfing, as you say, when the self relaxes, automatically the experience is that it's peaceful.
Yeah. Well, anything that we can do to connect ourselves with the world is we're going to experience as peace,
When you say connect to the
because
world, you mean direct reality, like a direct
yes,
relationship to reality.
us and the world
Yeah.
mean mean more non-dual absorption into the experiences coming through the senses are always the world and us together. But we interpret those experiences very much from the point of view of me versus the world.
Subject and
that
object.
The very basis of subject-object. Like Krishnamurti was so wise, he said, all the tragedies of the human condition lie between the subject and the object.
100%, yeah. 100%.
It's an amazing, amazing quote. But the subject-object duality is fundamentally not peaceful. And in a very, I'm talking now in quite a deep place, as much as you can merge with the world, your awareness connecting with the world, peace, deep peace will appear. People feel it even without meditation when the difference between walking in the city and being in nature, because nature talks to the nature inside them. So they feel more peaceful walking in the forest than they do walking in the city, because of that there's a voices of nature talk to the voices of the nature in them. So there's more connection or connectivity naturally. But meditation practice or Dharma practice, in which we undo the friction between us and the world and the barriers, obstacles, contractions and conditionings, so the world and us become more connected, and then we find peace. And in a very simple way, if we are doing, for example, anapanasati, mindfulness of breathing in and breathing out, the way to peace in meditation on the breath is simply to be curious, interested, and connected to the breath, close to the breath. The intimacy with the breath will create peace, not, oh, I want to find peace, though I have to do meditation on my breath. Just drop the I, or I want, and just be intimate and curious and interested. What's this breath? And just like, you know, an artist that's painting will feel concentration and inner peace as a result of connection and intimacy, the intimacy.
And it's a very, very delicate relationship to the object, the mind observing the breath or whatever it is. The relational conditions of observing an object, observing the breath, are very, very delicate to drop into that place of pure curiosity about what's happening.
And
you were saying before, when we become mindful, we start to see the triggers, the buttons, the how our minds are working. But another thing that we begin to see is we begin to see the infinite potential that is pregnant in the moment, and it can only birth if we have that right amount of mindfulness.
Now, I should say another definition of peace, which is also on a deep level, is equanimity. And the equanimity is really in some way the goal of the Buddhist practice. So the goal of Buddhist practice, or the goal of Dharma spiritual practice, is, if you want to have a goal, there's not really a goal. Goal is awakening. But shall we say, synonymous with that goal, or close to that goal, is actually not peace but equanimity. It's that's the language used for states of liberation, which are innately peaceful, but equanimous is a better word for that.
Yes.
And it simply means that we are fully engaged with reality, fully connected with, we allow reality to touch us, but it doesn't cause friction. It doesn't land in us.
It doesn't stick anywhere. It doesn't hit us.
It doesn't cause disturbance.
Yeah.
Reality doesn't disturb.
So this comes back to the whole idea of self and other and the boundaries that we have. Whenever there's a self, there is others, and there's boundaries. And I believe the Upanishads said early on, even before Buddhism, that, you know, as long as there is self, as long as there is other, there will be fear. Because that places a boundary. And whenever we have these kind of rarefied boundaries, the boundaries that are rigid, that are not permeable, not flexible, that they can't dissolve and relax, we'll never be equanimous. Because boundaries are bouncing around all day, you know. Even if you live in a cave up in the Himalayas, you're going to be hitting the boundaries in your own mind.
But boundaries have to be maintained. Boundaries are constructions that we make.
Right.
Boundaries are a result of attachment.
Right.
It's interesting that I've been I've been doing some science. I'm basically a scientist by training. I have a PhD in molecular biology from London. And but now, and I've written like 40 scientific papers in my life, suddenly I find myself the guinea pig. And bunches of scientists at the Weizmann Institute and in Tel Aviv in Bar-Ilan University have been doing lots of experiments on myself.
I've joined
In
those experiences. I've joined
yeah,
with
you were yes, you were that.
with
That's right. They told
Aviva.
me
Yeah,
yes.
and Aviva is going to be in this series of talks as well. We're going to speak to Aviva a little bit
Yeah,
later.
great.
Yeah.
Well, what they were testing in my case is boundarylessness. That
Yes.
means states of no boundary,
Yeah.
and it's states of infinite or unlimited states. And it gave me plenty of time to contemplate in a rather specific way this issue of boundary. And what it's very clear that a boundary, such as between you and the other, which is based on defense, on insecurity, and on vulnerability, has to be maintained. It needs work to keep going with a boundary.
Yes.
It needs the fuel of attachment. You
Constant
need you,
maintenance.
maintenance. It's a habit. A boundary is a habit. If you can really deeply relax the habit of maintenance of boundaries, you
Right.
will find yourself in boundarylessness states of less boundary.
Yes.
Just like, you know, in a very, again, a very simple image of being in the forest and just lying under a tree and feeling yourself just kind of part of the earth and part of the trees. It's a beautiful feeling. It's totally relaxing. It's when you don't need to maintain any boundary. And by itself,
Yeah.
you let go and you feel there aren't boundaries
Yeah.
in this moment.
And reality is perfect as is.
That's right.
Nothing needs to be adjusted or maintained
Yeah.
or tended to. It just happens by itself.
Yeah.
Well, we
Yeah.
spoke before this Skype call. We spoke about we were speaking a little bit about what we were going to talk about, and you said there's you talked about the there's a few mistaken concepts in meditation. And one is that, you know, going to be, you know, this when you drop into boundarylessness, in a way, there's kind of naturally you retreat. That's why we take retreats. You retreat from the world, and you're not so engaged in the world. Now, how do you, from this place of dissolved boundaries, which is a deeper state of a mature state of meditation practice, how do we enter back into the world without contracting back down into solidified suffering boundaries?
Yeah, it's an interesting point. I think that to step, firstly, we have to see that we are already engaged in the world. We can't not be in the world.
Right.
So every thought and every sense, the senses are connected to the world. Our language, our thoughts, our actions, we are already spontaneously and constantly engaged.
Even on a
So
retreat, even on a retreat,
even on a retreat,
especially on
even
a
on a retreat,
retreat, especially.
especially on a retreat, we are constantly engaged. And so withdrawal of the body into a retreat state, withdrawal in 45 minutes meditation in the morning, shutting down, shutting off the telephone, shutting down, reducing, closing our eyes, reducing the amount of stimulation, all of that is a purposeful and a little bit of an artificial withdrawal from the world into a cave, which is very helpful. It's a laboratory where we discover powers. But the powers that we discover in those places of withdrawal, which are not different to, for example, the Jewish Sabbath, a place of stopping, a withdrawal from resting, a place of renewal, and it's fine as long as we're not Buddhas. I think we're going to need to step
Completely.
out here and there in order to renew and refresh the awareness under the best conditions called minimum TV, radio, smartphones, disturbance. You know,
Seclude,
it's very,
secluding the mind, secluding a more
yes,
kind of mindful life. And the
it's
powers you're
great.
speaking of, these are spiritual powers.
Yes. So, but that is only giving us, in a way, the opportunity to develop qualities. And qualities are what we express in the world.
Yeah.
And the qualities that we express in the world are those that are, we want to refine and develop the qualities we express in the world. So the qualities that we express and learn through meditation are exactly being connected, being awake, not being on automatic pilot, being more aware of what's really going on with us in the moment, being able to dissolve conflict, difficulty, being able to see what's behind the eyes of someone that we meet in the street or the bus driver.
Very important, yeah.
All of those things are engagements. So what actually I think meditation does is help us engage and not help us shut down.
Yeah.
And that's one of the mistakes of meditation, because people say, oh, well, it puts people in a cave. It might do for 3/4 of an hour in the morning, and it's a blessing.
Yeah.
Or it might do for a week or a month if you need to go on a retreat.
Exactly.
But that's a blessing. But it's totally the opposite direction. I'll give you an example.
Sure.
A lot of people feel very stressed by having to make choices in life.
Mm.
And there can be big choices like divorce or little choices like which color shirt shall I buy. And the choices can give us real headaches. Actually, most of the actions we take in life are about choices. If we are at work, think of 100 choices we have to make during the day of what's effective and what's useful and
right.
what's helpful
right.
and what's right. So if we bring to choices a strong ego, a narrative called I have to work out what's best for me,
mm-hmm.
I have to know the result of these choices, therefore I have to know the future, which we cannot know. I have to design the future. I have to design what's going to happen, and it's a lot of pressure on me to make the right choice so that something will happen that I want to happen. A lot of conceptualization, of struggle, of inner conflict, of loops in the mind, of trying to work out the unworkable, which
yeah.
is the future,
yeah.
Of not being able to allow things to be what they are, to being dissatisfied, and also a lot of automatic thinking. All of that is kind of gives us the pain and its attachment. And instead of that, a deeper, more steady, more awake, more connected knowing, which is not just intuition. It's bigger than intuition. It's a quality of knowing the world as it arises. You will be able to spontaneously know what to do.
Exactly.
The choices become much, much easier
yeah.
and less painful. There's less habits in them and less past in them and less conditioning in them and less friction and less struggle and pressure and less measuring of outcomes.
Yeah.
You offer in this moment your wisdom and your qualities. I'm doing it.
And that's
the qualities.
No, that's one of the things we begin to kind of realize in Dharma practice is that most of the time our thoughts, our words, our actions are just repetitions of the past.
Yes.
And there's no novelty, there's no creativity, there's no spontaneity. And it's like you were saying, in a deeper state of mindfulness, this deeper state of equanimity, our thoughts, words, and actions are naturally evoked, they're purified, and they're always spontaneous, they're always creative, and they're always right. They're always like, there's right action, right view, right speech, come out from a deeper from a more mature awakening, let's say, or from when we're more grounded in the practice, the way that we speak, act, and live in the world is more wholesome.
It is. It's more wholesome, and it feels there's a rightness to it, but we don't know the results. I mean,
exactly.
we really have no idea that we can't force life. Life is bigger than us,
yeah.
So we may. You know, spontaneously, with all the wisdom and all the insight, go left and go right and get knocked down by a car.
Exactly.
Because we went left and not right.
Yep.
We don't know.
We don't know.
We don't know. But there's a rightness to the process.
Right,
and
exactly.
The manifestation, our manifestation in life, we improve, we purify the qualities with which you bring into the moment.
Mm.
And that's the key, because it's only qualities which fuel our actions. So only the qualities of heart, of compassion, of awareness, of peacefulness,
equanimity
and kindness, mm, and dana, of generosity. These are qualities we bring into life. That's what our life is. Our life becomes as a result of meditation, and that's super effective. I mean, I'm seeing, it's amazing the way it's been happening in my life. Just a very small example. I had a book to write some years ago, and I was on retreat, and I had a deadline. The publisher needed it while I was on retreat, and so I had to use every moment to write. I noticed the way that 10 minutes between one interview with a yogi and another, or one session and another, in 10 minutes, I was able to run to the computer, write for 10 minutes, close the computer, come back, and what I wrote was never needing any corrections.
Beautiful. That's amazing.
It was so, the creativity was so spontaneous, and especially because I was on retreat, and the creativity flows from a deeper place of qualities of being.
Yeah. So we've spoken about meditation. We've spoken about this inner peace and the qualities of being that are created, and now action in the world. Maybe I could start it with a quote from a man named D-Hawk. D-Hawk was a manager of some big corporations, also a meditator, and he did a lot of very innovative, what we would consider more wholesome change in these bigger organizations. And he said that intervention, any intervention is 100%, no, the success of any intervention is 100% dependent on the interior of the intervener. So the person who's actually involved, who is the agent of intervention, their interior completely determines the success or the outcome of that, our intervention. So maybe we could speak a little bit about action in the world from a place of dharma.
Mm. Well, there's many, many ways you can look at this, but maybe I'll just mention briefly one important quality of action in the world, and that's dana.
Yes.
And dana is the first of the paramis.
Yeah.
And
maybe you should, for the listeners, explain the param, or translate the paramis.
Okay, paramis are simply qualities, or paramis or paramitas. Mm-hmm. There's 10 of them in the Theravada tradition, and 6 of them in the Tibetan tradition.
Mm-hmm.
And they're simply qualities of the personality that is both the fruit of awakening and the cause of awakening. It creates awakening, and it's a fruit of awakening.
Right.
But it's qualities that we bring into the world in our personality, in the way we interact with the world. And the first of them is dana, which is a generosity, donation, giving, but also giving and receiving. And it's a very clear, deep understanding of the way the world works. The world doesn't work on the basis of having. The world works on the basis of interbeing.
Yes.
And interrelating.
Creates the cycle. By giving, actually creates the cycle. Not
there isn't anything. Yeah.
Yeah,
there
right.
isn't anything in the world that is having.
Yes.
There is only giving and taking and flow. That is the world. So that insight, which comes through a journey, our inner journey, or you talk about our inner world,
mm-hmm,
that's an insight which, when it grows, we begin to realize that our whole life is dana.
Yes.
We were given our life. We were given it, that something arrived and all the carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, and consciousness were collected together to make a miles.
Yeah. And we're a manifestation of abundance in that way.
Yes, exactly. And we were given this body, mind. It's a gift. And we give ourselves to the world, and we give ourselves when we die. And so the whole of our life is giving, whether we like it or we don't like it. We may have illusion that we're doing it for ourselves, but even something like money, it doesn't have any stability. It's right. always flowing. It's like water or air. So we're working for money and then we spend it. We work for money, we spend it. It doesn't stay. Nothing stays.
Right.
Everything is being given and taken. Everything is a flow. The tree gives to the earth gives to the tree.
Mm.
It's all a flow. So this is an example. So if you get up in the morning with that attitude, then it changes the way your actions, the quality of your actions in the world. You have no problem giving, but giving and receiving means you have to be in the flow. So you don't need to be tight and hold on and be in the pain of what can I get now? What can I maximize? How can I get benefit for me?
Right.
But you're in this flow, which is very joyful and free of giving and receiving. Of course you want to look after yourself. So you enjoy a good meal. You give to yourself. It's beautiful. Yeah. And you give to others. And that's the motive power of your life. So as a teacher, I'm giving, and it's such a joy to receive back. And people give to me, and I give to them, and it's all sort of flowing beautifully.
Yeah.
So here's an example of an inner state which is manifest in the world. And I want to give another example coming in a very practical way from peace work that we've been doing for many, many years in the Middle East. I've been setting up organizations, and I've been working in the peace field with Israelis and Palestinians, or with Israelis and Israelis, right wing, left wing, trying in a way to use the Dharma tools or Dharma directions to bring a little bit of relief to a state of intractable conflict that exists. And what we used to do, for example, is go to Palestinian towns and villages in the West Bank and bring with us groups of Israelis, and some of whom were soldiers but not in uniform, but I mean Israelis, young
sure,
Israelis,
right.
old Israelis, and
yeah.
bring them to meet Palestinians.
Create
in
the
a
connections.
Rather, yes, in a rather formal weekend structured way. But sleeping in Palestinian homes, which is quite a big thing for Israelis to do, and working together in using Dharma tools. So, for example, some of the qualities, the inner qualities we were developing in these weekends, I'll give you just a few examples. One of them would be a sense of kindness. That means we came with gifts. We made food for them. We allowed them and delighted in their hosting us, because very much in the Arab tradition,
right,
to give
the hospitality
food.
Yes,
the hospitality. It's like, so we allowed ourselves to be fed, and we gave to them and they gave to us. We gave them our gift of listening. We were really, really deeply listening to them, listening to their voices, giving them the respect of we hear you, we see you. That's already dana, that's already gift.
Mm.
And then using mindfulness and deep listening, we really were solving conflict with them by seeing the person who really, beyond the image or the othering or the status,
right,
or you Palestinian, we Israeli, but who are we really, and what is our experience really now? And the way we did that was to share our suffering.
Yeah.
We actually related to each other as human beings how we suffer in our daily life. We took in couples, we did this, one Israeli,
yeah,
one Palestinian,
yeah,
sharing deeply for 1 hour the suffering of their
the
life
pain.
And somewhere this awareness of mutual pain undid the barriers of separation,
totally,
of distance, and created friendliness, created warmth. And another of the qualities that we used in these weekends was metta or love. We were really, really developing it. We walked together. We sat together. We were developing all the time the quality of kindness and love to their children, to their cats and dogs, to the women, not just to the men, making sure that they were included, their kids were included, their neighbors were included. We walked around a little bit and were kind to, somehow using the tool, the Dharma tools of kindness, as a place of melting fear, hostility, and long-term long-term conditioning. And we made really big changes to people as individuals in that time when we were there. And in a very 48 hours was all we had together, we made a big difference.
Yeah. No, it's my experience too, because I have an amuta, a nonprofit called Aikido Without Borders. And for 8 years now, I've been teaching in the West Bank, and very similar experiences that you're speaking about. And it kind of occurred to me when I started this, when I moved to Israel, it was somehow my intention to also, from a dharmic point of view, because I didn't grow up an activist. You know, many people in the baby boomer generation in America, which I'm just at the end, do have this strong activism, but it was never me. But as a result of my practice, it became clear that all my suffering, my personal suffering, was about the internal boundaries, that parts of myself that weren't able to kind of, that were in conflict with each other. And as those boundaries resolved and I came together, I was able to open up, there was a huge reduction in suffering in my own life, and peace as a natural result of that. And then naturally, when I would see these boundaries in the world, you just feel at a dharmic level that it's like, you know, that's the suffering and being individual suffering being enacted in the world. And what bigger symbol of a boundary is there in the world, or at least one of them today, than the wall that separates Israel and the West Bank and Palestine? So quite naturally, I started, you know, I felt it's my job to cross the borders, to actually create bridges, and with no other agenda beyond that, to actually meet, like you said, at a human level, and just be with the so-called other. Let self and other come together to the point where those differences merge together in this intimate space that you're speaking of. And somehow, and it's like you said, it's a person-to-person, individual-to-individual, maybe group-to-group, but creating this kind of deeper understanding beyond the narrative that we're being bombarded with day in, day out.
Yes, absolutely. By the way, it so happens that this evening I'm giving a talk on Worldwide Insight, which is an international broadcast, and it's happening this evening, and it's also on the issue of conflict.
Oh, fantastic.
Yeah, so it just happened to be this evening.
Yeah, so you're warmed up.
So, and I also want to say that on my website there is an interview on Conscious TV, which is a one-hour interview, which actually goes into quite in-depth one or two of the practice themes we've been talking about, such as the relationship between duality and non-duality. In this particular interview in a British or international TV program channel called Conscious TV. So the link to that is on my website. Which is in English. I have a website in English and in Hebrew.
Well, I'll attach the link with this video. But just since we're here, what's the URL for your website?
It's stephenfulder.com.
Okay, so stephenfulder.
.com.
Well, Stephen, I think we've kind of gone on for about an hour here.
Yes, we have.
I want to thank you very much for your precious time.
And, it's and, great.
And even more so, I want to thank you for sharing your wisdom. And
I'm very happy.
I hope that we have a chance to do it again soon.
Delighted. Yeah. Great. Miles, thanks. And beautiful work you're doing. Yeah, and lots of blessings.
Yeah. Thank you very much.